from 243 to 250. So in the ayah number 243, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ خَرَجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ وَهُمْ أُلُفٌ حَذَرَ الْمَوْتِ فَقَالَ لَهُمُ اللَّهُ مُوتُوا ثُمَّ أَحْيَاهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَذُو فَضْلٍ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَشْكُرُونَ. So from here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Quran, the subject is being changed. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning an incident which happened with the children of Israel. So before this, a background of these ayahs. So this ayah is basically before Battle of Badr, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through this ayah is encouraging the believers to struggle on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do the jihad for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to spend the wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is more of a preparation for the believers, which battle is going to come, which was the Battle of Badr and then the subsequent battles. So here, if you look at the situation and the background, until this time, until Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to Medina and the Islamic State was established, there was no fights, there was no battles. It was all about preaching, giving dawah. So at this time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to encourage the believers who have in their the thoughts which were coming to them, that if they go for the fight in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they might lose their wealth, they might lose themselves, and that was the fear which was there among them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to remove that fear, and this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the ayah. So I want you to keep that historical background or the historical perspective when understanding this ayah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the believers and is telling them, have you not seen what happened to those people who left their homes, not one and two, but ulufun, that is, they were in thousands, and why they left? Fearing death. Then Allah said to them, die. Then He restored them to life, and Allah is a possessor of bounty for the people, but most of the people do not show gratitude. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to send this point across, that death and life are subservient to the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether you go out fighting, if you are not fighting because thinking that you might die, the death might come to you at your home. And if you are not spending because you might get poor, remember that the risk comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's the point of these ayahs. So going into a battle is not a cause of death, and running away from is not a means to avoid it. So for this ayah number 243, the incident which was mentioned, there are different narrations in different tafasir. In Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he explained this, that these were the people of the children of Israel. They were resident of a city. Then what happened was, there was an epidemic broke out. So in order to save themselves, they fled their land, obviously fearing their death, and took refuge in wilderness. Then they later arrived at a fertile valley, and they filled what is between its two sides. So they basically ran away from the epidemic, and they were in the valley, which was very fertile. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent two angels to them, and then all of them basically died. So now this calamity happened, and there were thousands of people who were dead. And then the people who were in the surrounding nearby cities, they came, and basically there is no way they can bury all of those people. They built walls and graves around that, where all the dead bodies were there. And that's how the bodies got rotten and disintegrated. And then he says that long afterwards, one of the prophet of the children of Israel, whose name was Hizqil or Ezekiel, passed by them and asked Allah to bring them back to life by His hand. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listened, He commanded the bones to come back, and that's how they were alive. So this is one narration. Another Mufassir, he mentioned that this ayah refers to the first state of the children of Israel. That is when, at the time of Musa alayhi salam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed the children of Israel to go and fight, they refused to fight. And they said, Musa said to Musa alayhi salam that you go and you can fight with along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then they were in the valley for 40 years, and that was their wilderness. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought them to life back again when they were able to capture the Palestine for the first time, and they were able to establish. So some of the Mufassirin has mentioned that. So what bottom line is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to convey this through this ayah, that divine decree overcomes human planning. So basically, you can plan anything. You might be afraid of something, but the thing is, whatever is decree, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for you, it's going to happen. So these people departed from their land, fleeing the epidemic and seeking to enjoy a long life. But what happened was exactly opposite, that they were all dead. And here's something which is relevant to our times as well. It is, the Mufassirin has mentioned in great detail explaining this ayah, the situation about the epidemics and how one should behave. And it is very much relevant to our times. As Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, that when you hear that a plague is in the land, do not go to it. And if it occurs in a land that you are already in it, then do not leave it fleeing from it. So this is the saying of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and that's a general ruling for any situation when we go through the epidemic. So this ayah indicate that, being cautious and being caution will not alter the destiny. So similarly, abandoning jihad will neither bring the appointed term closer nor delay it. So the fear the people had at that time was, if we go for the jihad, if we go for the war, then we might die. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to convey to the people through this example that life and death is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not you who decides. And the appointed provision and destinies are fixed, and it will not be changed and altered. One of the good example we can get from the history is Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala. If you see that Khalid bin Walid was always fighting, and when he was dying on his deathbed, he showed to one of his companion that there are no place on his body where there is no marks of something or other. But he died not as a shaheed, but he got a natural death. So the point is, the destiny is decided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are fleeing from something by the fear, it's not going to avoid you that. So after this introduction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the believers, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ, that and fight in the cause of Allah, and know that Allah is hearing and knowing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything, what you are talking in your small gatherings, what you have been discussing, your doubts about this command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fight. So Allah knows everything. But what Allah wants from us is, in that situation, believers were commanded was وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. So the incident relating to Bani Israel is an introduction to encourage Muslims to not hold back from struggling in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through their wealth and their selves, basically. Next ayah 245, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُقْرِضُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا فَيُضَاعِفَهُ لَهُ أَضْعَافًا كَثِيرًا وَاللَّهُ يَقْبِضُ وَيَبْسُطُ وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. That is, who is it that would loan Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a goodly loan, so he may multiply it for him many times over? And it is Allah who withholds and grants abundance, and to him you will be returned. So again, the same point, it is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot run away from your destiny. The reason why someone does not want to spend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they might be fearing the poverty, or they might be attached themselves to the different goals in their life. But the thing is, the richness or the abundance it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whatever is in your destiny, you're going to have it. And here, Qarz-e Hasana is a goodly loan, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is encouraging His servants to spend in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Qarz-e Hasana or the goodly loan signifies whatever one gives to another person selflessly. That is very important, that when you give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there should not be any strings attached to it. That you are giving certain cause, but at the same time you are expecting that you will have a say in it. And you are basically helping your brother, but at the same time you had certain expectations from him. So those are not the Qarz-e Hasana, because you have some selfish motives over there. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages from us is a Qarz-e Hasana, a goodly loan, which is selfless. And this is a hadith which is narrated in the Tafsir Ibn Kathir, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends every night down on the nearest heaven to us when the last third of the night remains, and states that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, who would give a loan to he who is neither poor nor unjust? That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that he may multiply it to him many times. So it is a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is saying, فَيُضَاعِفَهُ لَهُ أَضْعَافًا كَثِيرًا, that he may multiply it for him many times over. And in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the example of a grain, that one grain can have up to, that will lead to 700. Basically, you will have branches, and the branches will have the grains, and that is the 700 rewards, up to the 700 times you can get the reward for it. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking for us. So bottom line of these ayahs so far, 243 to 245, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling to us, giving an example of the nation or the people who were in large number. They wanted to run away from some kind of difficulty, but that did not save them from the death. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that you fight in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you give the Qarz-e Hasana for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the destiny is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is ready to multiply it for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically says that it is Allah who withholds and grants abundance, and to Him you will be returned, that we are all going to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So based on this ayah, the response of the Muslim Ummah at that time was different. There, so Mufassirin mentioned that there were three kind of reactions to this ayah. And we see that kind of reactions in our times too. At one of the reaction at that time was that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Lord is poor and we are rich. Then when this ayah came, the munafiqun or the hypocrites or the mushrikun, they mentioned that, you know, how come Allah needs the many? Looks like your Lord is a poor and we are the rich. And then the second kind of attitude is the attitude of miserliness, that people adopted miserliness as their way of life. The love and the greed of material provision tied them down. And then the third reaction was the sincere Muslims who were giving their best positions. And very famous of them, the story which we know is about the Abu Dahda. When after this ayah was revealed, he came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said that I have two gardens and I want to give it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed him that, you know, keep one for yourself and give one for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he gave the best one for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the dua Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to Abu Dahda was that countless trees laden with trees and spacious palaces are eagerly waiting for Abu Dahda. So that was the reward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had for the sincere donations and sincere contribution and a goodly loan when a believer has given. And that we have to learn from this ayah, that what is our attitude whenever we have been asked to spend on the for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one thing which will come to our mind is that, you know, if we spend the money, certain goals will not be achieved. That objective which I have to achieve, the money for which I am saving, that won't be happening very soon. And, you know, you might, you know, regular charity might decrease your wealth. These are the thoughts which will come, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that He is going to reward in multitude if you give it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So moving on, So far in this three ayah, what happened? First, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced, explained the story of Israel who were dead, although they wanted to flee some epidemic. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to send this point across that the destiny is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the story which happened about 300 years after the Musa alayhi salam, and it is when the children of Israel they were defeated by their enemies. The majority of them suffered losses, and several were captured, their lands were taken away, and they lost pretty much everything. And that's when this incident happened. Inshallah, we will go into details. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, alam tara ilal mala'i min bani israila مِنْ بَعْدِ مُوسَى إِذْ قَالُوا لِنَبِيٍّ لَهُمُ ابْعَثْ لَنَا مَلِكًا نُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ قَالَ هَلْ أَسَيْتُمْ إِنْ كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ أَلَّا تُقَاتِلُوا قَالُوا وَمَا لَنَا أَلَّا نُقَاتِلَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَقَدْ أُخْرِجْنَا مِنْ دِيَارِنَا وَأَبْنَائِنَا فَلَمَّا كُتِبَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقِتَالُ تَوَلَّوْا إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِنْهُمْ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِالظَّالِمِينَ So have you not considered the assembly of children of Israel after the time of Moses, when they said to a prophet of theirs, send to us a king and we will fight in the way of Allah. He said, would you perhaps refrain from fighting if battle was prescribed for you? They said, and why should we not fight in the cause of Allah when we have been driven out from our homes and from our children? But when the battle was prescribed for them, they turned away except for few of them, and Allah is knowing of the wrongdoers. So basically, if you look at the historical context of this story which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning. So after Musa alayhi salam, the children of Israel were in the desert for about 40 years. Then a new generation came, and then under the leadership of the Yusha ibn Nun, who was the prophet after Musa alayhi salam, they were able to conquer the Palestine. When they were in Palestine, they established their kingdom, and there was not one kingdom, but they have like 12 small kingdoms based on the 12 tribes of children of Israel. So they were there, but they were still, they have fightings among them. They had issues among them. They turned away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was corruption happening. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the enemies over them, and they were being drawn out from those lands, and then they were captured, and they suffered losses, and they lost their kingdom. So that's when this incident is happening. After those suffering, they came to the prophet of that time, and they requested this. So this is basically what happened, that the enemies attacked them. They were, great number of them were captured, and they took over the large areas of the land, and also they lost their tabut, or the box which has the remnants of the Musa alayhi salam and Harun alayhi salam. They lost that one also, and then what happened was, the prophet Shamuel, he was the prophet after this incident happened, and he was the one who was approached by the people. So when he reached the age of prophethood, Allah revealed to him, commanded him to invite the children of Israel towards the Tawheed. Then when he invited, and then at the suffering, this gathering, or the leaders of the children of Israel, they approached the prophet Shamuel, and they asked to appoint somebody as a king over them, so that they could fight their enemies under his command. When this proposal came, then the prophet Shamuel said to them, what if Allah appoints a king, will you follow him? Because the nature of the children of Israel until that time was, they were fighting among themselves, and they were not following the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the question is, what guarantee they have? If Allah now appoints another person as your leader, will you fight, or will you turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then they answered, saying that, how come we will not fight? when our land has been confiscated and our children had been taken away from us, definitely we will fight. But when the fighting was ordered,